Dr. Fred Bell's Health Science and Energy Show, February 24th, 2007. How, now, those of you guys that are listening to, welcome to TAN Talk Radio, people down in Florida too, by the way. Those of you guys that have been listening to my Friday show, that's a $200 seminar that we normally charge for tape-wise that you're getting for free, and that's going over a session probably of about 2-3 months. And it'll be archived, and of course, if you want to buy it, it's $200, so we're saving you some money. A little later on in the show, we're going to have Steve Barish on board, and I really enjoyed the Don and Wynn show tonight. That was a really good one. This is getting to be like a sitcom, you know, and I think that these guys have something to go on TV with. I love how Don and was talking to Wynn about, you know, getting all the hosts together. You know, that's very important. You know, all these really tight cable programs and programs where they run a series of things like MSNBC and CNN and Fox News, all the hosts are pretty tight. That's really good. And all the hosts that are out there listening to me tonight on BBS Radio, I apologize because I haven't had time to get in the loop yet, but most of you know me anyway. And my email is fredbell@pyridine.com. So anyway, I want to talk a little bit about a couple of things tonight. And the first topic that I want to talk about is lasers. Light amplification by stimulation emission of radiation. And I have a particular reason to talk about that tonight. And that is that we are actually in what I would call the laser revolution right now. And the laser revolution means that if you go on eBay or anywhere you go, every company is selling lasers. And tonight I'm going to talk about where all this started and why all it started and what the fervor is for it now. Lasers, light amplification by stimulation and emission of radiation. Okay, lasers, you know, developed back when I was working at NASA, and we had what they call MACER amplifiers, microwave stimulation by emission of radiation. What a MACER amplifier was originally used was it was used for a large thing called a radio telescope. And this is before lasers. And what the radio telescope was all about was, if you remember Francis Drake back in 1966, who was part of the very first SETI project, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence project, had a very large radio telescope with a MACER amplifier in it. And what a MACER amplifier is, it's an amplifier that is submerged in liquid nitrogen. Now, why would you want to put an amplifier in nitrogen? It's so that it will amplify signals with a very low noise-to-signal ratio out of nothing, okay? And so that's why they had to do that. They actually started out originally making these amplifiers. Then the idea was that if there was any extraterrestrial race available, that possibly they would realize that the universe is made up of, we talk about all the time, the same as the human body, oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, and carbon. Hydrogen being the atom of consciousness that we deal with in all our laser systems and our projector effect, you know, in our receptor systems. We're always talking about the hydrogen atom, as you know. So, with that in mind, they began to realize that any smart extraterrestrial intelligence group would probably know what the frequency of hydrogen is, which is a very, very basic, and it's also basic number one on the atomic scale. So they tuned their amplifiers in these telescopes towards the frequency of fundamental hydrogen, set up their these what they call filters, which are also in hydrogen. Basically, the MACER was a filter, and they wanted to listen to some form of hydrogen modulation or variation coming from deep space that varied from the constant and consistent sounds coming from the large solar bodies like suns and stars, etc. In 1966, Francis Drake made contact. Out of that noise came a large beep, 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 and he reported it. And of course, because of what had happened at Roswell earlier, the program was classified, and he was basically at that point, that program was shut down. Well, that was the beginning of masers and lasers. Later on, in the laboratories over at Hughes Aircraft, experimentation started to go with a ruby rod, And this is back in the late 50s now. Early 60s. The ruby rod, it was found, could be made to oscillate in coherent light by stimulating it with white light. And what happened was, in a ruby rod, all of the photons were dormant and the electrons were active. So when you would stimulate the ruby rod with a white light source, okay, now a white light source is a source that has seven different colors. It was found that the ruby rod, when stimulated by a white light source, only picked up on the green frequency, which we would call the female energy or the yin energy in our receptors. It only picked up on the green energy. And when it picked up on the green energy, it started sending a coherent waveform in the optical frequencies from one end of the polished rod to the other. Well, they found out right away nothing, it didn't go any further than that, so they decided to put mirrors on each end. And so by using a mirror surface, then what happened with a mirror surface, they were able to reflect this small coherent energy back into the rod again, and then out through the rod to the mirror on the other end of the rod. So you can imagine a mirror surface oscillating back and forth. And this was beginning the first beginnings of the laser system. Okay. Next, they had a problem with cooling. Cooling didn't work. So they had to work on ways of cooling the laser. And once the cooling system was in place, they were actually able to put a little bit more energy into it and increase the output. And so therefore, they could actually start to get a visible beam. And that, of course, began the beginning of powers of lasers. As time went on, we graduated from the ruby laser to the helium neon. Then they found this was a gas medium. They decided to put a gas medium. And this became the helium neon laser, which all of you saw worldwide as the little red laser. And, of course, these were incredibly expensive like everything else in the very beginning. Then, as time went on, the procedure of making these lasers became less and less expensive, and they became affordable. And that's about the time that I entered the scene. Now, there's two people that entered the laser scene worldwide before I did. First one was Ivan Ponadel, who set up a very old-fashioned but very expensive system at Mount Wilson called Laserium. And then later on, a friend of mine named Fred Lord set up a system over in Caesar's Palace in the Imperial Palace in Las Vegas, which notoriously became all of the laser systems in Las Vegas. So these were the two first people that started initiating this kind of energy into the world public. Well, right away, people picked up on it. The Laserium light show, I went and saw it when I was a kid and thought it was very amazing. And so I enjoyed the heck out of it. Became friends with Fred Lord later on, saw all his tricks and techniques. So one day, I decided that I wanted to bring lasers out to another medium. I wanted to bring them out to the general public where they were going to be affordable. I had had an electronics company previous to that, and my electronics company used to sell a lot of test equipment to a fledgling company in San Diego called Mel's Griot, M-E-L-L-E-S-G-R-I-O-T, if you look it up on the website. Well, a friend of mine was one of the founders of the Mel's Griot company. So I went down there one day and I asked him, I said, could I trade you some test equipment or some lasers? I want to play with them.